Okay, good morning. I'm Cristina Tejedor. First of all, I want to thank the organizer for coordinating this interesting session and for accepting our proposal. So I'm going to present the research project that is being developed in the domain of El Pendón, which is giving a very exceptional and unexpected results. I will show the result of technique during the excavation session of 2016 and 2017. So, the dolmen of El Pendón is located to the south of Reynoso, a small village of the province of Burgos in the north of Spain. Its location on the top of Páramo, in a dominant position from the valley and flatlands around, turns the monument into a significant spatial referent in surroundings. An elevated area, we can see now, I think, an elevated area as a natural platform was used for its construction, and this gave the place a greater monumentality. The first publication of the monument was by Jacinto Campillo in 1982, and in this work he only presented a brief description of the structure, and of the some remains were recovered on the surface. But he already referred to the several human bones that appeared in the removed sediment inside the chamber. Ever since, this monument has been included in all lists of megalithism of the province of Burgos and always have described as a looted and destroyed single chamber. The state of abandonment of the dolmen made to the municipality of Reynoso promote its excavation and valorization. In the summer of 2016, an archaeology company start works with the only aim to discovering the structure for its conservation and recovering some archaeological remains. But when in a few weeks they observed that some excavation areas looked intact, they contacted with Manuel Rojo, professor of the University of Valladolid, to propose a collaboration with his research team. Since then, we have led the excavation and further studies of the monument. From the beginning, we proposed a suitable methodology that could answer two fundamental questions. What type of megalithic construction was, and what phases of use and possible reuses had. In this sense, we considered an open area excavation in order to understand what happened in the whole monument at the same time. Taking into account that in the megaliths there is usually no horizontal or vertical stratigraphy. The excavation surface covered around 20 square meters, seven of which corresponds to the chamber. We used a combination of topographic and photogrammetric tools for a stratigraphic and spatial record of the general plans and of its structure and some specific details. In addition, we carry out an exhaustive photographic documentation. For the ossuary, we design a specific recording system based on the detailed documentation of the position and orientation of each human bone, taking several measurements for each one. For example, in the case of long bones, the coordinates of both ends are topographically recorded, checking first that anatomically closest to the spine. Furthermore, we did a systematic sampling of for DNA and paleoparasites analysis, and also we have selected sediment samples for flotation according to the stratigraphic units. So, thanks to this methodology, we were gradually discovering and giving answers to the question that we considered at first. Regarding the architectural type, as I said before, this monument was classified as single chamber. However, we quickly realized that it should have an access as a vestibule or short corridor. This type of megalith is not usual in the inner of Iberian Peninsula, but is usual in other peninsular regions such as Galicia or northern Portugal. But as the excavation advanced, the evidence pointed more and more to the hypothesis that it was a passage grave. But at some point in its biography, it lost the corridor. Therefore, originally, it was a monument of large size and very monumental for this region. The diameter of the chamber has more than 3 meters, and it should be composed by 8 or 9 orthostats. 7 of them are in situ today. The corridor could have reached between 6 or 8 meters of length, although we have not yet documented its original layout completely. On the other hand, we could reconstruct a large patch of complex sequence of events that took place in this megalith. The oldest phase of use corresponds to its construction and original use. And in this sense, one of the most interesting findings has been that originally, as I said before, it was a passage grave. Its foundational use was oriented fundamentally to a funerary role, and the original ossuary has composed by thousands of human bones in secondary position and covered all the space of the chamber. The finding of several labeled skeletal pieces like phalange, bones of wrist, sternum, or eoids or pteroids like Ferran presents in Can Sadurní, and some anatomical connections points to the hypothesis that this place really worked as primary deposit of the bodies, whose remains were removed after its decomposition. A special feature of this ossuary is the large number of children bones, because the representative of this age range is usually low in this type of burial context. Also, it should be noted the diversity of pathologies and injuries documented in the bones. The material culture associated with this first phase is the usual of megalithic in the Iberian Peninsula, such as microliths of flints and blades of flints, and bone or stone beds or other ornamental elements such as this perforated whiteboard teeth. So, although we don't have radiocarbon dates yet, we think this phase will develop throughout the first half of 4 millennium Calvici. At a specific moment of its biography, this dolmen underwent a process of closure, which entailed a complex sequence of practice that affected both the ossuary and the corridor, and also the area of the entrance of the chamber. The result was the transformation of this space, going from being a funerary place to a kind of ceremonial center or symbolic monument. Both the chamber and the corridor were completely sealed by medium-sized limestone blocks, like we can see in the picture. But before the closure of the chamber, practice of rearrangement and skeletal selection has been carried out in the chamber. It is a level composite for the most part of intentional assemblage of human bones, placing according to specific ritual patterns. It has been possible to identify different ritual funerary practices, such as the accumulation of remains to the periphery to the chamber, and the presence of intentional bone assemblage, such as skull nets, long bone sets, like in the picture, or the most singular finding until this moment, monument that is the assemblage of skull and pelvis. In the same area, in the area of the entrance to the chamber, a large fire was made with several combustion focus close to each other, covering the complete width of the corridor. On this fire, several skulls were intentionally placed, which have appeared with different degrees of alteration or fire. One of them reaching a complete calcination, like the one of the picture. In the same area of the entrance of the chamber, we document two pits completely filled of, with human bones, but with the singularity that they appear mixed with fauna, especially bovids and ovicaprids. During this complex process of closures, the corridor will have been dismantled, since at this level it has been possible to document, like in the picture, some of the foundation ditches of the orthostat of the passage. It is possible that, if not all, part of those dismantled orthostat were thrown into the chamber covering the prehistoric ossuary levels. As in the previous phase, we still don't have radiocarbon dates to corroborate our hypothesis. But in the same way, the chronotypological study of the materials associated with this moment suggests that this phase took place during the first half of the third millennium Calvisi, the period known that pre-Vicar Chalcolithic. In this sense, we can highlight a large group of arrowheads made on flint and of different typologies. No clear evidence of later reuses has been documented, but this fact does not mean that the monument was forgotten or abandoned. In addition, if this level existed, would have been the most affected by the modern removals. So, the complex biography documented until now in this dolmen could be summarized in this picture. First, construction and use as collective grave. Second, the rearrangement and skeletal selection in the ossuary and the large fire of the, at the entrance of the chamber. Third, the sealing of chamber and corridor and excavation of two pits with remains of fauna. And last, the dismantling and final closure by throwing the dismantling orthostat into the chamber. Finally, a new excavation season was carried out in El Pendón last July, but its results are still in process of study. Our main goal has been to document the complete corridor, as you can see in the picture, and to try to discover the area of the entrance to the monument. This objective has been achieved, but new findings have opened new questions that we will have to try to resolve in a future season. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
There's some stunning photographs. Stunning. Great. So now we move on to Rafael Martinez, who's going to be talking about bury me on the mountain and do not heat the grave.
Thank you very much. First of all, on behalf of my colleagues, I would like to thank you for the opportunity to participate in this event. I would like in particular to thank to Penny Beaker, Juan Gibaja and Maria Eulalia Subira. I hope that this communication will be of interest to everyone here. As the title indicates, the funerary context that we present is under a rocky outcrop as a burial mound, a natural building or structure, an inlier on or Einzelberg of Ordovician rocks, surrounded by a softer relief. This site is located in the municipality of Ovejo, Cordova, next to the road Ovejo-Villarta site and Guadalbarbo River in the Guadalquivir Basin. It's placed in central Sierra Morena, a geographic region that lacks examples of burial deposits in natural caves. Even though both dolmenic chambers and Copper Age and Late Neolithic sites are known, are abundant. This fact is explained by the domain in the landscape of rocks later prone to karstification. The site could not be classed as cave due to their narrowness. The axis can be reached after a short climb and creeping down a narrow tube that leads to a small cavity. This is a 4 to 2 meters plant crack of irregular shape, filled with stone blocks where it's almost impossible to stand up. This was discovered by cavers that were prospecting the area following literature or reference about the find of one cave with prehistoric pottery and a stone placing access hole inside. On first access to the site, discoverers were surprised by the finding of a fragmented handmade pottery vase and some bone fragments, which suggested the presence of a prehistoric funerary context inside. One of the most striking features of Sirve was the existence of the remains of a closure or wall that blocked the access area, made up of two large stone blocks. The evidence of fractured speleothems was also noteworthy because, as we could see on the end of the intervention, they served to prepare the positional space. This discovery led us to carry out an archaeological project, given the limited size of the deposit, which we carried out in difficult condition during 2016. From the beginning, we divided the intervention area into two sectors. Naming the eastern sector, the widest, as sector one, and the western sector, the narrowest, as sector two. In both cases, the surface was covered by a rock chaos and a very dusty sediment composed mainly of bat guano. Throughout the excavation, we discovered very fragmented human bones and some partial remains of fauna. In the same way, ceramic gray goods, in some cases complete, were also revealed. As well, the intentional nature of the rock arrangement contained in the crack, as well creating platform for the placement of the funerary deposits. In this slide, we can see two ceramic vessels in sector two, placing a narrow hole in the crack, the largest containing a fragment of skull. This is important to consider the difficulty of taking photographs in such a small space. Given the depositional character of this site, all the findings were coordinated and positioned in up to 10 planes, also due to the impossibility of taking accurate photographs in the narrowest and deepest parts. At the end of the intervention, we were able to see how stone and some stalactite fragments have been used to blind the connection between the crack and the access gallery, located below and with access to the outside. In total, the crack chamber, reaching a deep of 2 meters in this archaeological finding, with a section of about 2 meters, 70 meter maximum height. This is the plans. The human remains recovered are 282 fragments and mainly poorly state of conservation. They show a very unusual taphonomic state, conserving the presence of fat-like material in some cases and almost the composite flaky texture bone in others. In both cases, bones were very dry. They represent at least 5 individuals, 3 adults, 1 male and 1 elderly female, 1 subadult aged about 12, and 1 child aged 6-7 years. Among the recovered great goods, at least 8 ceramic vessels stand out, 2 of them carinated bowls, which indicates a chronology about around the second half of the 4th millennium Cal BC. A gold metatarsal punch and a quartzite varnish complete this first set. Undoubtedly, the most exceptional character of this site is the conservation of organic material. Thus, we have recovered various plants remains, such as acorns, wood branches, and up to 57 fragments of cork boards of similar width, 13 millimeters on average, which can be used as artifacts to support the human remains. Although they are clearly elements that have been introduced, we have not been able to identify working surfaces, showing no clear spacing association between them. In the case of other preserved organic remains, their characterization as contemporary to the archaeological deposit is more controversial. The finding of 2 eggs placed next to 2 ceramic vessels may, in the absence of radiocarbon dating, still correspond to a clutch of a rock bear species. In particular, it would correspond to red bile chug, discarding other possible crows taxa based on morphological, morphometric, and spotted pattern criteria. In the case of insects, we are currently working on their identification, having determined the presence of dozens of flies pupaceae in different species, as well the action of insects on the osseous and organic material. The most spectacular find in this is up to 4 fragments of textile partially preserved. This is an exceptional finding in the Mediterranean, and it has been preserved not by carbonization, as usually happens here, but by desiccation and by the acid nature of the sediment. This fragment, made of vegetable fiber, possibly flax, show plain weave fabric and Z-twist, as in most of the examples now for the copperheads in the Iberian Peninsula. Radiocarbon chronology, still to be completed, has been carried out on cork and textile samples. This, as had already been anticipated by the ceramic typology, points toward the middle of the 4th millennium Cal BC for the burial process, ensuring, on the other hand, the age of the organic material identified. Pro- preliminary findings is a crack in the rocky outcrop prominent over the surrounding landscape was used as a burial site for a limited growth of people towards the end of the Neolithic in central Sierra Morena, an area that is regarded as marginal for the archaeological research. Due to the particular taphonomic feature of the site, linked to the acid content of the soil that covered the remains, they have benefited from excellent conservation conditions. Thus, organic remains, rarely now in archaeological context in southern Iberia, have been preserved, such as wood, cork, and textile, including insect remains. For the case of textiles, this may be the oldest directly documented in the Iberian Peninsula. Both the ceramic typology and in particular the first result of radiocarbon dating place the use of this context in the middle of the fourth millennium called BC. Thank you all.